Hi, I'm Meris, and in this video, I'm going to be talking to you about the gravida and para numbers, Nagele's rule for calculating estimated due date, and I'm also going to be talking to you about the different types of labs and diagnostics that are done during prenatal care. So I'm going to be following along using our maternity nursing flashcards. These are available on our website, leveluprn.com, and if you already have a set of your own, I would absolutely invite you to follow along with me. So let's go ahead and get started. We're going to be starting talking about GTPAL or GTPAL. These are the numbers used to represent how many pregnancies and different types of deliveries or outcomes that a patient has had. So G stands for gravity. Gravity with a D, not a T. So gravid means pregnant. So gravity means how many times has this patient been pregnant? No matter what the outcome, okay? No matter what the outcome, how many times has this patient been pregnant? Then we're moving on. So G, gravity, just talking about pregnancy. Now we're moving on to the para numbers. So this is how many times a patient has had different types of outcomes. So term, G, T. T is for term. So the next number means how many term deliveries, meaning past 38 weeks, has this patient had. Then we move on to preterm. How many preterm births has this patient had? That's going to be from the age of viability, around 20-ish weeks, 24 weeks, through 37 weeks. Okay, so how many times has this patient been pregnant? How many term deliveries? How many preterm deliveries? The next one, the A in GTPAL, is abortions. Now keep in mind that abortion is a medical term, which means that a pregnancy has ended. It is not a term that means elective or therapeutic abortion, meaning something that was induced. It can mean that, but it can also refer to spontaneous miscarriages. I want to caution you to be very careful about how you use this word around patients, especially those who have had miscarriages or losses. We in the medical community may know that this just means the loss of a pregnancy, but your patient may not. And then the L means how many children are living now, okay? So I'm gonna do a quiz with you at the end, so see if you can calculate some GTPAL numbers. And then gravida terms, nulla gravida means never been pregnant. Premigravida means first pregnancy, and then multigravida means multiple pregnancies, two or more. So you will hear, sometimes you'll say like, oh, she's a primip, like meaning she's never had a baby before. So just good to know those terms. Then moving on, we are talking about Nagele's rule. So Nagele was this guy who came up with the rule for how you calculate the estimated delivery date of a patient. Now, the estimated gestational age in human beings is 40 weeks. So, Nagele said, if you know the first date of the patient's last menstrual cycle, subtract 3 months, then add 1 week, and then add 1 year. It's very confusing. The point being, really what we're doing is we're getting 9 months and 1 week in the future. So we have Cathy's easier rule, which is add 9 months and 1 week to whatever the patient's last menstrual period was. The first day of the last menstrual period is used to calculate this because it's 40 weeks from that date. So at conception, you're actually 2 weeks into the gestational cycle, if that makes sense. All right, so for example, if the first date of the last menses is April 1st of 2020, Nagele says that you would subtract 3 months, which would make it January 1st, 2020, add 1 week, January 8th, 2020, and then add 1 year, January 8th, 2021. Cathy's rule says April 1st, 2020, we're gonna add 9 months, that gives us January 1st, 2021, and then add another week, January 8th. All right, now moving on, these last two cards are pretty hefty, okay? There's a lot of information on them because it's super important in this class to understand what the testing is in pregnancy. It's very different from testing that you've learned about at any other time in the program. So starting off, let's talk about HCG. This is human chorionic gonadotropin. It's the pregnancy hormone. This may or may not be done, and it just kind of depends on your patient, but it can be done. Now, RH factor, we talked about this in the last video. we have to know what the patient's blood type is. We have to, because if I am Rh negative and I have a baby who is Rh positive, the first time nothing is gonna happen probably. We're gonna mix blood at delivery. And then if I should ever become pregnant again in the future with an Rh positive baby, my immune system is going to recognize that antigen as being foreign, as being a threat, and it is going to attack that baby in something called erythroblastosis fetosis. Okay. It's not a good thing. So we can end up with the baby dying because of this. So if we take Rogam, which is an IM injection, if we take Rogam, it's actually going to suppress that immune response so that we don't end up making those antibodies against the Rh factor. So you'll see here that we administer it at 28 weeks, very, very important timing. But we also give it within 72 hours of delivery. And then anytime there's some sort of pelvic or abdominal trauma or vaginal bleeding. Okay, super important to know. So those were some labs. MSAFP is another lab. MSAFP stands for maternal serum alpha fetoprotein. So this means it's measured through the maternal serum, through the patient's blood, not through the fetus. And this helps to screen for some genetic abnormalities. So an increased MSAFP is indicative of neural tube defects, but a decreased MSAFP can be indicative of Down syndrome. And we do have our cool chicken here that MSAFP will be down in Down syndrome. Now it's important to know this is not diagnostic. It does not mean this is what's happening. MSAFP numbers can be off for a lot of reasons. So if we did get a high or a low result, then we would want to follow it up with an amniocentesis to confirm. So then the next thing on this card is the glucose tolerance test. So this is the gestational diabetes screening test. What this is going to be testing the patient's response to glucose to help us identify gestational diabetes. So the 1 hour glucose tolerance is the screening one that is done on all pregnant patients that consent to it, usually 24 to 48 weeks. No fasting is required. They're gonna drink a 50 gram glucose solution. We're gonna wait an hour and we're gonna draw their blood. If it is above 140, that's the magic number, 140, then we are going to move on to a 3 hour glucose testing. If it's below 140, we say, good, you don't have gestational diabetes, you can carry on with your life. But if it's above that, then we're going to move on to the 3 hour. Now with the 3 hour, that's a fasting test. You have to arrive having had nothing to eat or drink except for water. And then they will give you 100 grams of glucose to drink. But before they do, they're gonna draw your blood. So they're gonna get a fasting level on you. Then you're going to drink the stuff, wait an hour. Then you're going to have a 1 hour, a 2 hour, and a 3 hour blood test to see what your glucose was. Any two results being out of whack is diagnostic for gestational diabetes. So if I come in and my fasting level is a little high, but the 1, 2, and 3 hour are good, it's fine. I don't have gestational diabetes. But if 2, 3, or 4 of them are elevated, then we are thinking, yep, this is gestational diabetes. So important to know those cutoffs so that you can help to better educate your patients. All right, so that is it for the GTPAL and then also for Nagele's rule and some labs and diagnostics. I hope that was helpful. If it was, please like this video or leave me a comment so that I know. And you definitely want to subscribe so that you can be the first to know when the next video in the series drops. Thanks so much and happy studying. First, let me say, so I passed my 1 hour glucose with my daughter, my first baby, and that was great. And then with my second one, I failed miserably and I had to do the 3 hour and I passed, but I am a very hard stick. So it was a very treacherous and scary 3 hours. But okay, so let's do a GTPAL calculation. So you have a patient who has had, two live births. She has had two term deliveries. She has had one preterm delivery, and she has had 7 miscarriages. She currently has 2 living children. So what is your GTPAL calculation for this patient? Go ahead, pause it if you need to, think about it. I'll be here when you're done. So the G should be 10, right? So she had a preterm delivery, and then she had 7 miscarriages, right? So we have 10 total pregnancies. And then the T number should be 2. She had 2 term births. The preterm, the P, should be 1. She had 1 preterm birth. And then the A number, abortion, should be 7. She had 7 miscarriages. And then the L number should be 2 because she only has 2 living children. I hope that was helpful.
I invite you to subscribe to our channel and share a link with your classmates and friends in nursing school. If you found value in this video, be sure to hit the like button and leave us a comment and let us know what you found particularly helpful.